the investigation of things and the investigation of principle to the utmost. In reply to Chu Chang Wen's letter, Master Cheng Yi said, "Only when our minds understand the way can we distinguish right and wrong. It is like having a balance to weigh things. This is what Mencius meant by understanding words. I understand the principles of things as expressed in words. If our mind does not understand the way and we try to determine wherein the ancients were right or wrong, it is like reckoning weight without a balance. After having exhausted the strength of our eyes and tired out the wisdom of our minds, although we may hit the mark occasionally, it is like what the ancients called repeatedly hitting the mark through imagination. This is not valued by the superior man." In a letter in reply to his pupils, Master Cheng Yi said, "Were Confucius and Mencius' pupils all virtuous and wise? Of course, many of them were just ordinary people. As ordinary people, when they observed the words and deeds of the sage and the worthy, many of them did not understand. Precisely because they did not trust themselves but trusted their teachers, they made searching efforts and finally understood. Now, when you gentlemen do not agree with what I say, you let the matter go and think of no more of it. This is why you are in the end different from the followers of Confucius and Mencius." Do not leave the matter alone, but think of it further. This is the way to extend knowledge. In a letter in reply to Master Hung Shu, Master Cheng Yi said, "Your discussion generally shows evidence of hard thinking and the utmost effort, but not the spirit of ease, gentleness, or warmth. Yours is penetration not through clear intelligence, but through thought. Consequently, your ideas have often been one-sided. Your words have often been inexpressive, and you have often made slight mistakes. To penetrate through clear intelligence is like seeing with the eye minute and subtle things, knowing all of them. To arrive at penetration through thoughtful investigation is like estimating and conjecturing about things. You can only roughly see their resemblance. How can you avoid errors? I hope you will completely nourish your thoughts and deliberations and cultivate moral principles. Someday your mind should naturally function smoothly. To find out whether one has succeeded in learning or not, one can examine his own mind and vital force. When he has achieved something in his thoughts and deliberations, and is delighted in his own mind and feels abundantly enriched, his achievement is real. If, however, after he has achieved something in his thoughts and deliberations, his mind is tired and his vital force spent, he has really not achieved anything. He has merely conjectured that he has. Once I heard someone say that of late, in studying the way, he had thought and deliberated in that, as a result, his heart had become weak. I said, man's blood or vital force may of course be weak or strong, and sages and worthies cannot avoid illness when it comes. But I have never heard that the heart of anyone, from ancient sages and worthies down, ever became weak as a result of study. People today believe in all kinds of supernatural things and strange tales simply because they do not clearly understand universal principle. If they try to understand principle in everything, that seems strange. When will there be an end? You must try to understand universal principle through learning. If we understand principle clearly, we can judge all supernatural things according to it. According to principle, some things are regular and others are not. Supernatural things need not seem strange to us. Although the patterns of realization of those who attain to humanity once a day or once a month and those who attain to it for a long time without cease seem to some extent alike in meaning and in disposition, they are far different. One must inquire deeply, understand quietly, and ponder for a long time, and then he will probably find out for himself. If a student is to learn from a sage at all, he must deeply ponder over feelings and dispositions of the sage, and must not try to understand him merely in terms of words. If he does that, what he studies is nothing but writing. In the case of those who have nothing contrary to humanity, humanity lives in them like a host. He does not stay at home always, but occasionally leaves the house. In the case of those who attain humanity once a day or a month, humanity is outside like a guest. Although he comes in, he does not stay long. Someone said, one can make a special effort in advancing virtue through loyalty and faithfulness, but it is very difficult to extend knowledge. Master Cheng Yi said, a student should make a special effort at advancing virtue, but he must know before he can act. If he does not know, he will merely watch Yao and imitate his behavior. Without Yao's quickness of apprehension, intelligence, insight, and wisdom, how can one act and appear in the proper manner as Yao always did? To advance virtue with effort, as you say, means to believe in it earnestly and adhere to it firmly, and does not mean to possess it originally. To wish to make the will sincere before one has extended one's knowledge is to skip over steps. If one's practice requires effort, how can one hold on for very long? The fact is that if we clearly understand principle, we will naturally and joyously follow it. Man's nature is originally good, it acts in accordance with principle. Therefore, it is, after all, not a difficult thing to follow principle. People say it is difficult because they do not know principle and on the spur of the moment resort to manipulation. There are many kinds of knowledge, some exceedingly profound and some exceedingly shallow. The student must know truly. As soon as he knows what is correct, he will practice it serenely and keep on doing so. When I was 20, I interpreted the meanings of the classics in no other way than I do today. But when I come to think of it, I feel that today they mean something quite different from what they meant at the time when I was young. There is principle in everything, and one must investigate principle to the utmost. There are many ways to do this. One way is to read books and elucidate moral principles. Another way is to discuss people and events of the past and present, and to distinguish which are right and which wrong. Still another way is to handle affairs and settle them in the proper way. All these are ways to investigate the principle of things exhaustively. You must investigate the principle of things to the utmost. Then we can see the right and wrong clearly. If a thing is right, we will do it. If evil, we will not. One must personally realize right and wrong. If we can personally do so in discussing literature or in handling affairs and gradually extend our realization, our position will be extensive and broad. We must investigate principle in the things and affairs we deal with. For example, when we read, we investigate principle in the printed word. When we listen to others, we investigate it in conversation. When handling affairs, we investigate it in the affairs themselves. Whether things are refined or coarse, big or small, we must investigate them all. After a long time, we shall understand them, and the coarse will become refined, and the small will become big. In the investigating things, is it necessary to investigate everything, or can one know all principles by investigating any one thing? How can one understand everything this way? Even Yanzi would not dare say he could understand all principles by investigating only one thing. We must investigate one item today, another item tomorrow. When one has accumulated much knowledge, he will naturally achieve a thorough understanding like a sudden release. After we understand one layer, there is another layer under it, and after that, another layer. From simple to complex affairs, we must try to understand one after another. From difficult to easy principles, we must try to understand one level after another. As we continue to try to understand, we shall reach the utmost. To devote oneself to investigating principle to the utmost does not mean to investigate the principle of all things in the world to the utmost, nor does it mean that principle can be understood merely by investigating one particular principle. It is necessary to accumulate much knowledge, and then one will naturally come to understand principle. The virtue of thinking is penetration and profundity. When you think for a long time, penetration will naturally come about. If you do not succeed in thinking over one thing, well, think over another. Do not stick to this one thing. For as your knowledge is beclouded here, you will not understand even if you force yourself to think. Suppose someone's will is set to study, but his knowledge is beclouded and constricted and his strength inadequate. What can he do? The only thing to do is to extend one's knowledge. If one's knowledge is clear, his strength will naturally be improved. Through observation of things and self-examination mean returning to the self and seeing principles after some principles have been discovered in things. You do not have to say it in this way. Things in the self are governed by the same principle. If you understand one, you understand the other, for the truth within and the truth without are identical. In the extension of knowledge, how about seeking first of all in the four beginnings? Four beginnings of human nature, namely humanity, righteousness, propriety, and wisdom. From Mencius. To seek in our own nature and feelings is indeed to be concerned with our own moral life, for every blade of grass and every tree possesses principle and should be examined. From the principles in one's own person to those in all things, if one understands more and more gradually, he will naturally achieve a far-reaching understanding. From the ultimate of non-being and the great ultimate above to a small thing like a blade of grass, a plant, or an insect below, each has its principle. If we fail to read one book, we shall miss the principle of one book. If we not investigate one affair to the utmost, we shall miss the principle of one affair, and if we do not investigate one thing, we shall miss the principle of one thing. We must understand them one by one. The virtue of thinking is penetration, profundity, penetration, profundity lead to sagehood. To exert thought is like digging a well. At first there is only muddy water. Later on, after one has done some drawing, clear water will come out. One's thoughts are always muddy at first. After a long while, they will naturally be nicely clear. What is meant by reflecting on things at hand? To extend on the basis of similarity in kind. This is well said. We must not skip over steps and aim too far, nor should we stray to the right or to the left. We must only proceed from what we understand and what is near to us and move from there. For instance, if one is thoroughly familiar with doing one thing, he can, on the basis of this, extend his skill to doing another. It is the same with knowledge. If one knows how bright this lamp is, he can, on the basis of this, extend his understanding to know how bright that candle is. It is like ascending steps, going from the first to the second, from the second to the third, and from the third to the fourth. For example, if one understands how to be affectionate to his parents, he will extend this feeling on the basis of similarity and kind to being humane to all people, for being humane to all people and being affectionate to parents are similar in kind. When he understands how to be humane to people, he will extend this feeling on the basis of similarity and kind to loving all things, for being humane to all people and loving all things are similar in kind. The student must first of all know how to doubt. Reply to Fan Sun Shi, Master Hung Chu, Changsai, said, "It is not difficult to discuss the strange things and monstrous beings you inquired about, but you may not believe in what I say. Mencius said, he who knows his nature knows heaven. When one has studied to the point of knowing heaven, nature, then how things originate should be abundantly self-evident. When one knows how things originate, then whether there is such and such a thing will be completely understood, and one need not depend on any discussion to know. If you gentlemen hold on without fail to what you have discussed, are not overcome by heterodoxical doctrines, and keep advancing without stop, you need not refute the theories of monstrosities or attack heterodoxical doctrines, and within a year our way will win. If you abandon yourselves to the position that the number of monstrosities is infinite and give yourselves the idea that they are unknowable, your study will then be confused by doubt and your wisdom obscured by material things. Monstrosities will come one after another without interruption. In the end, you will not be able to maintain your own position and will surely be submerged in monstrosities and falsehood." Zikong said, "We cannot hear what our master said about human nature and the way of heaven, since he said what our master said. He means that Confucius often talked about these things when he sat down with his pupils." followers of Confucius felt it was the responsibility to realize humanity. They did not consider casual knowledge as sufficient, but insisted on real understanding before regarding themselves as having heard. This is why Tse Kong spoke as he did. To know casually is merely to hear the doctrine, whereas really to understand is to apprehend the principle profoundly. In the study of moral principles, one must be thoroughly immersed in them before there can be any achievement. It is not something to be obtained through a simple, easy, or casual effort. If in one's study one cannot probe and examine the principles of things, it is because one's mind is not refined enough. Even in the case of Yenze, who did not reach this stage of the sage, the reason was that his mind was not refined enough. Someone asked, is it not too much to say that Yenhui is not refined enough? Zhuxi answered, compared to ordinary people, he was completely pure, but compared to Confucius, he was coarse. For instance, whenever he made a mistake, he never failed to realize it, and having realized it, he would never do it again. This is how refined he was, but he still made some mistakes. This made him coarse. Anyone who makes the least mistake shows that his mind is not refined enough. In the extensive study of literature, it is necessary to go through obstacles repeatedly so that the mind becomes penetrating, for only after one has experienced obstacles and difficulties will his mind be penetrating. Responding to things, handling affairs, and so on are similar to studying literature. If we drill and polish ourselves in the principles of things and studies, our minds will naturally be penetrating. Take reading, for example. Often, even after a great deal of thought, we cannot see through to the real meaning. As we try and try again, we find obstacles everywhere, blocking us in all directions. There must be a way to go through. In a case like this, there are many difficulties and obstructions, but repeated effort will find a way to go through. To go through means that the mind penetrates. Whenever there is any doubt about moral principles, one should wipe out his old views so new ideas will come. Whenever one's mind penetrates something, he should note it down. If he does not think, his mind will be blocked again. Furthermore, he should seek the help of friends. Each day he discusses things with friends, each day his ideas will become different. One must discuss things and deliberate like this every day. In time, he will naturally feel that he has advanced. Whenever in our effort at thinking we come to something that cannot be expressed in words, we must think it over carefully and sift it clearly again and again. Only this can be considered skill for learning. As for Kaozi, whenever he came to something that could not be expressed in words, he would stop and inquire no more. Master Chung-Yi said, when we read, we must first of all understand the meanings of the words. Only then can we find out the ideas of the text. It has never been possible to understand the ideas without knowing the meanings of the words. Students must find things out for themselves. The six classics are vast and extensive. At first, it is difficult to understand them completely. As students find their way, each establishes his own gate and then returns home to conduct his inquiries himself. That will do. Asked what the gate meant, Zhuxi said, the method of study, for example, if you want to read this book, you must know how to read it. In trying to understand writing, if one's mind is at ease, he will naturally see principle. Principle is nothing but the principle inherent in man. It is very clear, like the level road. The Book of Odes says, the road to Cho is as smooth as a whetstone, and as straight as a dart. This is what it means. This is what it means. Someone said, I am afraid the words of the sage should not be looked upon as easy to comprehend. Some of the sage's words are, of course, easy to comprehend, and others are deep and profound. If they are easy to comprehend, how can we artificially make them deep and profound? Yangzi said, the words of the sage are as far away as the sky, and the words of the worthy are as near as the earth. I want to change it to, the words of the sage are as far away as the sky, and as near as the earth. Among students, those who do not rigidly adhere to the literal meanings of words turn away from them completely, while those who understand the literal meanings of words adhere to them so rigidly that their minds become blocked. For instance, in the case of Zichojutsu's acting as a general, Mencius approved only the idea of not rebelling against one's teacher, but some people have insisted on trying to understand from the story how to serve the ruler, or take the case of Wan Chong asking about Shun's repairing a granary and digging a well. In answer, Mencius merely gave the basic idea, but some people have insisted on trying to understand how Shun came out of the well or how he came down from the granary. This kind of study merely wastes spirit and energy. In reading books, we should not rigidly stick to one meaning because the words are the same or similar. Otherwise, every word will be a hindrance. We should see what the general tone of the passage is and what the preceding and following ideas are. For example, beauty in this saying, "He whose goodness is extensive and solid is called a beautiful man," and beauty in the Book of Odes are different things. The beauty of extensive and solid goodness refers to the beauty in oneself, whereas the beauty described in the Book of Odes refers to the beauty of others. In cases of this sort, we should not rigidly stick to one meaning. Ying Cheng said, "I once loved to read Wen Chengzi. Someone asked him about studying the Book of Changes. He said that the sentence, 'Be active and vigilant all day,' will do. This saying covers everything. After all, King Wen became a sage in no other way than by being unceasing in his efforts." King Wen, 1171 to 1122 BC. The teacher said, "In explaining the meanings of the classics, if one allows himself to go from one point to another and to keep extending, I know he will cover everything. However, the sentence, 'Be active and vigilant all day,' does not cover everything in the Book of Changes. The sentence can merely be used to explain the characteristic of the third undivided line from the bottom of the hexagram. If one says that being active and vigilant means to be unceasing, and furthermore, that to be unceasing means the way, thus extending step by step, of course one sentence will cover everything in the classic, but according to principle, this is not the way to proceed. Students of the classics must be comprehensive and refined. They must investigate the final objectives of the classics to the utmost before they can understand them. To pick a sentence out of context, claim that it covers all the meanings of a classic, is not the way to study it. Rather, it is the defect of aiming too high and of oversimplification." Confucius, standing by a stream, said, "It passes on like this." He meant that the nature of the way is like this. Here we must find out for ourselves. In the transforming process of the universe, the past has just gone and the future continues to come. They continue without a moment of rest. This is the nature of the way as it originally is. But the running stream is something that can be pointed to and easily seen. Therefore, Confucius used the fact to teach people. He wanted students to examine things at all times without the slightest interruption. Juxi. In saying that the sentence, "Be active and vigilant all day," is not enough to explain the Book of Changes entirely, and that one cannot understand the passing stream through the idea of infinity alone, Cheng Yi was teaching the student to read books earnestly and not to make a superficial interpretation the basis of high-sounding, sweeping, or loose words. Cheng Yi said, "This means infinity." The teacher said, "Of course it means infinity. How can this single idea of infinity tell everything about the passing stream?" People today do not know how to study books. Take the passage. Though a man may be able to recite the 300 odes, yet if, when he is given a governmental position, he does not know how to act, or if, when he is sent on missions to various states, he cannot give his own answers. Although he has read much, what is the use? Although before one has studied the Book of Odes, he does not know how to act in the government and cannot give his own answers. After he has studied the book, he understands how to act in the government and can give his own answers in various states. Only then can we say that he knows how to study the Book of Odes. Or take the passage, one who has not studied the Chonan and the Shaonan is like one who stands with his face right against the wall. Before one has studied the Book of Odes, he is like a person facing the wall, but after he has studied the book, he will not be facing the wall. Only in this way will his study be successful. Generally speaking, this is the only method of studying books. Suppose one studies the Analects. If, after having studied it, one is still the same person as before, he has not really studied it. When we read passages such as those concerning matters that take up 7 years, a generation, or 100 years, we should in all cases think over how they were carried out. Only then will the reading be beneficial. In the Analects, Confucius said, "Let a good man teach the people 7 years, and they may then be employed in war." He also said, "If a true king were to arise, it would still require a generation for humanity to prevail." Again, he said, "If good men were to govern a country for 100 years, they would be able to overcome the brutal and eliminate killing." And looking into various degrees and time elements of the governmental effects of sages and worthies, we must examine the essential character of their patterns and the methods of their execution before we can derive any benefit. This is the method of the extension of knowledge. In interpreting the classics, there is no harm in differing from their original meaning, except for important points on which we must not differ. When Tun first came, he asked about the methods of study, and the teacher said, "Sir, you should know that to study one must read books. One need not read many. The important thing is to know their essentials. If one reads a great deal without knowing the essentials, he is but a bookstore. Because as a youngster, I was greedy and read a great deal. I have forgotten much of it now. One must explore and get the real taste of the words of the sage, remember them, and then exert effort to put them into practice. One will naturally gain something." As an introduction to virtue for the beginner, there is no book better than The Great Learning. Among the rest, nothing is better than the Analects and the Book of Mencius. I want people, first of all, to read The Great Learning to set a pattern, next to read the Analects to establish a foundation, next to read the Book of Mencius for stimulation, and next to read the Doctrine of the Mean to find out the subtle points of the ancients. The Great Learning contains definite steps and a regular order. It is a coherent treatise and is easy to understand. It is true that we should first read the Analects, but its ideas are scattered and is difficult to read at first. The Book of Mencius can stimulate and arouse the reader's mind. The Doctrine of the Mean is difficult. One should read it after having read the three other books. Reading the Great Learning is different from reading the Analects or the Book of Mencius. In these two latter books, each conversation involves a particular principle. For example, when Mencius talked about humanity and righteousness, he talked only about principle appertaining to humanity and righteousness. When Confucius told Yan Hui to discipline himself and to return to propriety, he talked only about principle appertaining to self-discipline and returning to propriety. The Great Learning, on the other hand, speaks of principle in general. It discusses the operation of principle in the highest degree, that is, peace throughout the world. But the way to bring peace to the world is first to order the state. The way to order the state is first to regulate the family. The way to regulate the family is first to cultivate the personal life. The way to cultivate the personal life is first to rectify the mind. The way to rectify the mind is first to make the will sincere. The way to make the will sincere is first to extend knowledge. And the way to extend knowledge is first to investigate things. The student should first read the Analects and the Books of Mencius. If he has studied them thoroughly, he will get the fundamental points. He will save a great deal of effort if he reads other classics on the basis of these. Two books are like the measure and the balance. When things are measured and weighed by them, which is long and which is short, and which is heavy and which light, will naturally be seen. The intellect deals with self-cultivation and the preservation of one's mind and nature, while the Book of Mencius deals with the personal realization and the extension of the originally good nature. In teaching people, Mencius talked mostly about moral principles and the great foundation, while Confucius taught mostly concrete and earnest effort. In reading the Analects, simply consider Confucius's pupils' questions as your own and the sage's answers as what you have personally heard today. Then you will get something. If you can look into the Analects and the Book of Mencius deeply and explore them and get the real taste of them, eventually your cultivation will reach the point of maturity at which your physical nature will become excellent. In reading the Analects and the Books of Mencius, do so thoroughly and explore them and get the real taste of them. Apply the words of the sage to yourself earnestly. Do not merely treat them as so many words. If people will but look upon these two books as being meant for concrete application to themselves, they will derive much benefit throughout life. There are people who have read the Analects without having anything happen to them. There are others who are happy after having understood a sentence or two. There are still others who, having read the book, love it. And there are those who, having read it, unconsciously dance with their hands and feet. Students should use the Analects and the Book of Mencius as the foundation. When these have been well studied, the six classics can be understood without study. This means that the classics will be easily understood. The Analects and the Book of Mencius require less effort but will yield more result, whereas the six classics require more effort but will yield less result. In reading, we should examine the purpose for which the sage wrote the classics, his motive in writing them, and why the sage reached the position of a sage, whereas we have not been able to reach that point or to have the achievement ourselves. Reaching refers to action, whereas achievement refers to knowledge. Inquire into every sentence, brood over it in the morning and think it over at midnight. Have a calm mind and a peaceful disposition, and put aside what is doubtful, and you will see the purpose of the sage. If one reads the Analects and the Book of Mencius without understanding the way, what is the use, although one has read much? If one reads the Analects and the Books of Mencius many times, he will fully understand their meaning. The student must brood over them and get the real taste of them. If he tries to explain them literally, he will never get the full meaning. Some time ago, I annotated the two books, but when I came to think of it, I felt my annotation was superfluous, so I merely corrected some misunderstandings on the part of certain former scholars and put the books in shape. One should read the Book of Mencius differently from the way he reads the Analects. The latter should be read coolly and quietly, whereas the former should be read thoroughly and intimately. In the Analects, each word or idea deals with a particular principle, and therefore it must be read carefully and quietly. The Book of Mencius, on the other hand, consists of long passages, each forming a harmonious whole from beginning to the end. If the two books are read thoroughly, their meaning will become clear. One should not try to understand them word by word. Someone asked, suppose we concentrate on the important points in the Analects and the Book of Mencius. What do you think? Zhang Yi answered, this is of course good, but even if one learns something from the books, he does not really become at home with them, for our way is different from that of Buddhism, which once understood will take one off the realm of emptiness and silence. In the Analects, there are important points and there are general remarks. To direct one's effort only to the important points means to discriminate. If that were the way to study, much of the Book of Mencius could have been deleted. We must thoroughly understand the words of Confucius and Mencius, regardless of whether they are precise or general. For moral principles are great and extensive. Some can be easily explained and others are more difficult. Some are generally and others are precisely expressed. If one does not understand all, one's mind will surely be blocked. Being stimulated by poetry means that one expresses his own feelings and character, cultivates himself, and functions smoothly in his moral life, gets the feeling of being stimulated and aroused, and thus has the disposition for which Confucius approved Zeng Tian. Master Cheng also said, being stimulated by poetry means to have one's good intentions aroused so that they become broad and extensive and one's entire personality is characterized by them. Cheng Hao. Xie Liang Zhou said, Master Ming Tao was skillful in discussing the odes. He would never explain line by line or verse by verse. He would only brood over the odes leisurely to get the real taste of them, softly chanting them in a rising and falling voice. In that way, he enabled one to achieve something. On the ode which says, through days and months I have been longing and longing, the way is far. When will he return? He merely remarked, thinking earnestly indeed. On the last verse of the ode, which says, oh, sirs, I do not know your virtuous deeds. You dislike none and covet nothing. How can you but be good? He merely said, this means to arrive at correctness. She also said, in discussing the odes, Po Chun, or Chang Hao, would not utter a word of literal explanation. Occasionally, he would alter a word or two to tidy up the verse and recite it. That was enough to make people understand. Xie added, this is why the ancients highly value being intimate with students and influencing them. Master Ming Tao said, the student should by all means read the Book of Odes. Reading the Book of Odes will enable one to advance a step. How do readers of the Book of Odes know how to advance a step? Although the function of the odes to arouse the sentiments is the least important of its functions, it is the function that stimulates people. If the reader is stimulated by the poet, he has advanced a step. Do not use the words of an expression to spoil it. A word is a term of expression. If you mention only a term, that is a word. When words are grouped into a phrase or a sentence, that is an expression. It is not right to interpret a poem by just one word. One must make some allowance in interpretation. Take, for example, the Cho has not been prominent. In a literary composition, this should be the way of expression. Cheng Yi, in reading the Book of History, one must understand the way of the two emperors and the three kings. Take the two canons. They are the places to find out how Yao ruled the people and how Sheng served his ruler. Asked about reading the Book of History, Zhu Xi said, it is better to read the Great Learning. The Book of History goes into much more detail about ordering the state and bringing peace to the world. Cheng Yi, the Doctrine of the Mean is a work transmitted through the Confucian school. This transmission was completed by Zhu Su and Mencius. Although the book is a miscellaneous collection, it makes no distinction between what is refined and what is coarse, but talks about them as a synthetic whole. When people discuss the way today, they usually neglect the low when they talk about the high and neglect the secondary when they talk about the fundamental. Asked about the Doctrine of the Mean, Zhu Xi said, it is rather difficult to understand. In my order of reading, I must first read the Great Learning earnestly, then the Analects earnestly, and the Book of Mencius earnestly. After one has read these three books, he will already understand half of the Doctrine of the Mean. One does not have to ask others about it, but should read it through himself in a general way. One should not cast aside the easy part and begin by tackling the difficult part. The Doctrine of the Mean talks a great deal about intangible things on a high level, such as spiritual beings and forming a trinity with heaven and earth. It talks little about learning on the low level and much about understanding on the high level. It is all right if one understands its meaning. In talking about the way, the Doctrine of the Mean includes both the high and the low, and both the fundamental and the secondary aspects. Cheng Yi, Master Cheng Yi's preface to his commentary on the Book of Changes says, the Book of Changes concerns transformation. It teaches people to change according to the situation in order to be in accord with the way. Such remarks as these of Cheng Yi's are not easily acceptable. He arbitrarily considered this book to be concerned with human affairs. He meant to say that Confucius wrote this book simply because human affairs, by their very nature, involve many things. As a book, it is comprehensive, great, and perfect. It is intended to bring about accord with the principle of nature and destiny, to penetrate the causes of the hidden and the manifest, to reveal completely the nature of things and affairs, and to show the way to open up resources and to accomplish great undertakings. The concern of the sages for later generations may be said to be complete indeed. Although we are far from antiquity, the classic that was left to us is still extant. But former scholars have lost sight of its ideas and have only transmitted its words, and later students have recited its words and have forgotten its meaning. Since the Qin Dynasty, 221-206 BC, its ideas have been no longer transmitted. Now, living 1,000 years later, I mourn the obscurity and possible disappearance of our cultural tradition. I have written this commentary in order to enable later generations to follow its developments and trace its source. In the Book of Changes, there are four principles characteristic of the sages. We should highly value its remarks as a guide for us in speaking. We should highly value its changes for the initiation of our activities. We should highly value its forms and symbols as a guide for us in inventing and making utensils. We should value its prognostications for our practice of divination. However, the principles of good and evil, fortune, and of the rise and fall of things, and the way of their advance or retreat, and of their existence or destruction, are fully contained in the remarks. If one makes inferences from them and examines the hexagrams, one can understand transformation. Forms and symbols and prognostications are all included in the remarks. The changes in the Book of Changes are an embodiment of principles. Its changes provide the proper timing for activities. Its forms and symbols, such as heaven, earth, wind, fire, offer patterns for the invention or making of utensils, and its fortune-telling gives a clue to the future. While a superior man remains quiet, he observes the forms and symbols and broods over the remarks. When he starts any activity, he observes the changes made in divinations and studies the prognostications from them. There have been those who understand the remarks but miss their ideas, but there has never been anyone who missed the remarks and yet could understand their ideas. Principle is most subtle, whereas forms and symbols are most obvious. Substance and function come from the same source, and there is no gap between the manifest and the hidden. Substance and function come from the same source means that, although substance leaves no trace, function is found in it. There is no gap between the manifest and the hidden means that the hidden is found in the manifest. Before the existence of heaven and earth, all things were present. This shows that within substance there is function. After heaven and earth have come into existence, principle still exists. This shows that within the manifest there is the hidden. He examines how principles converge and what principles will prevail without obstacles so he can act according to the proper standard. This means to examine how the various principles converge, select the one that is applicable, and act according to it. For instance, suppose there is a matter involving many principles governing the relations between father and son, between ruler and minister, and between husband and wife. If the relation between father and son is important in this case, one should go ahead and direct his action to the relation between father and son, and if necessary, overlook the others. If the relation between ruler and minister is important, one should go ahead and direct his action to the relation between ruler and minister, and if necessary, overlook the others. If the love between father and son is important, then the principle of not daring to injure our bodies, hair, or skin because we have received them from our parents applies, and the doctrine of sacrificing oneself for the ruler will not do. If the righteousness governing the relation of ruler and minister is important, one should sacrifice one's life and overlook the doctrine of not injuring oneself. This is called examining how principles converge and what principles will prevail without obstacle. All this is found in full in the remarks. Therefore, one who knows how to study will look for the words of sages that are applicable to things at hand. Those who take things at hand lightly do not understand words. My commentaries are on the remarks, but getting the ideas from the remarks depends on the reader. In answer to Chung's letter, Master Chung-Yi said, I have not transmitted my commentary on the Book of Changes because I feel my energy has not declined, and I still hope to improve the commentary somewhat. In your letter you said that the principle of the Book of Changes originates with number. It is wrong to say that its principle originates with number. There must be principle before there can be forms and symbols. There must be forms and symbols before there can be number. The Book of Changes clarifies principle by means of forms and symbols, and from forms and symbols number is known. If you know the principle of the Book of Changes, forms and symbols as well as number are found in it. Principle is without physical form. Therefore, principle is made clear by means of forms and symbols. As principle is revealed in the remarks, forms and symbols can be observed through them. Therefore, I say that if the principle is known, forms and symbols as well as number are found in it. If you insist on investigating to the utmost the forms and symbols, no matter how hidden or subtle, no matter how infinitesimal, you will be looking for the derivative and pursuing the secondary. This is what the schematists and occultists highly value, but it is not something to which we Confucianists devote our efforts. Before Chung Yi's time, the Book of Changes was interpreted as a book dealing with forms and numbers. Only from the time of the Chung school on has it been interpreted as a book expressing moral principles. The moral principles of Master Chung's commentary on the Book of Changes are excellent, and its expressions are adequate. There is not an iota wanting. The work of other commentators is no more than patching. How can it be as spontaneous? But Master Chung's commentary is not in accord with the original meaning of the book. Basically, the Book of Changes is a book of divination. Its text on the hexagrams or on their component lines contain everything. How to use them is left to people, but Master Chung talked about them only in terms of principle. Master Chung's commentary is not concerned with the literal meaning of the text, but only with moral principles. This aspect is most interesting. The commentary is complete in its discussion on principle, but deficient on forms and numbers. The fundamental method of studying the Book of Changes is to know times and circumstances. In the Ta Chu Great Accumulation Hexagram 113, the two undivided lines at the bottom being the substance of the Tian Trigram are strong and firm and yet not sufficient to advance. The fourth and fifth lines from the bottom are feminine and weak and yet can stop the advance. Students of the Book of Changes should know thoroughly whether the time is high or low and whether the conditions are strong or weak. In hexagrams, although the second and fifth lines from the bottom are out of place in most cases, they have the excellence of being the mean. And although their third and fourth lines are in the proper positions, yet sometimes they lack the merit of being in the middle. With regard to the mean, correctness is always emphasized. To be in the middle means not to violate correctness. Correctness is not necessarily identical with the mean, but of all principles in the world, none is better than the mean. This can be seen from the Yang line in the second position and the Yin line in the fifth position. 117. Being in the middle of their trigrams, they represent the mean. Someone said Master Hu interpreted the fourth undivided line as that of the prince. I'm afraid this is not the meaning of the hexagram. The teacher said, there is no harm if the interpretation is applied correctly. If it should be interpreted as the position of the prince, let us so interpret it. The fourth undivided position is near to that of the ruler, and there is no harm in regarding it as that of the prince, but we must not restrict ourselves to one particular thing. If so, then the 384 lines of the 64 hexagrams are but so many particular things and no more. Someone said, in discussing the Book of Changes, Chung-Yi talked too much about principle. Chung-Yi said, the sage can apply it to the sage and the worthy to the worthy, and that if each line is applied to one event, since there are only 384 lines, there would be only 384 events. This is well said, but nevertheless, when he explained the lines, he treated them as 384 lines applying to only 384 events. In reading the Book of Changes, one must know how to apply its remarks in accordance with the circumstances. Remarks on the six lines of a hexagram can be applied by everybody. The sage can apply them in the way of the sage, the worthy in the way of the worthy, ordinary people in the way of ordinary people, the student in the way of the student, the ruler in the way of the ruler, and the minister in the way of the minister. There is none by whom they cannot be applied. Thereupon someone asked, the Kun earth female hexagram deals with the affairs of the minister. Are its remarks useful to the ruler? The teacher said, why not? Take for example the remark, the superior man supports men and things with his abundant virtue. Why can't this be useful to the ruler? So how? The Book of Changes deals with nothing but the principles of reversion, of coming and going, and of rise and fall. In the way of yin and yang, each advance is followed by a withdrawal, and each increase is followed by a decrease. Reversion, coming and going, and rise and fall can be seen in this process. Chung-Yi, the Book of Changes written by the sages is suitable for everything from heaven, earth, the hidden and the manifest, to insects, plants, and minute things. The Book of Changes includes all and is suitable for all because it represents the root and ultimate of principle. Fundamentally, it is the one thread running through all. People today read the Book of Changes but do not know what it is. They merely push their way through it without regard to principle. If someone has not read it carefully, you may add one characteristic to a hexagram and he will not realize that something has been added. You may take one characteristic away from it and he will not realize that something has been taken away. Suppose someone does not know this stool. If a leg has been taken away, he will not know that something is missing, and if a leg has been added, he will not know that there is one too many. If he knows, it will not do, of course, to add or to take away anything. Yu Tingfu asked Chung-Yi about the saying, that which is unfathomable in the operation of yin and yang is called spirit. Chung-Yi said, sir, you have asked because you have some doubts about it or because it is difficult to understand. Yuzhou probably had not thought over the matter deeply. He asked too soon because the sentence is difficult to understand. For this reason, Chung-Yi did not give him the answer but directly attacked his mind so he would return to himself and make an effort to think. Chung-Yi showed his commentary on the Book of Changes to his pupils and said, it tells only 70%. People who read it must later realize the rest themselves. Master Chung-Yi's preface to his commentary on the Spring and Autumn Annals says, among heaven's creatures there must be outstanding, talented men who rise to become rulers to rule the others, to govern them so that quarrels will stop, to direct them so that the mutual sustenance and support of life will be accomplished, and to teach them so that the principles of human relations will become clear. And then the way of man will be established, the way of heaven will be completed, and the way of earth will be stabilized. Up to the times of the two emperors, sages, and worthies appeared in the world. Yaoanshun. They instituted things as the times required, following what was proper to the situation. They did not start things for men before they were outwardly necessary, but instituted governmental measures according to the times. As the three kings successfully rose, the three important things were complete. The 11th the 12th and the first month of the lunar calendar were set up by the three kings as their months respectively. Faithfulness, substance, and ornament were progressively valued. The way of man thus became complete, and the way of heaven universally operative. Since then, sage kings have appeared no more, although the rulers of empires wanted to imitate the observable facts of the past. They only acted erroneously from selfish motives. As an example of how wrong a thing can be, the Qin went so far as to set up the 10th month of the lunar calendar as its first month. As an example of violation of the way, the Han controlled the world with cleverness and force exclusively. Did they any longer know the way of the ancient kings? The Grand Master lived at the end of the Zhou Dynasty, believing that no more sages would arise and that the government that was in accord with heaven and responded to the times would not prevail again. He wrote the Spring and Autumn Annals to be the great law which the kings of the next 100 generations would not alter. It is something that may be described in the words, tested by the experience of the three kings and found without error, applied before heaven and earth and found to be without contradiction in their operation, laid before spiritual beings without question or fear. It can wait 100 generations for a sage to confirm it without a doubt. A biography written by a former scholar says that neither Zhu Yu nor Zhu Xiao was able to contribute a word. Actually, the sage needed no help in words, rather they were not qualified to participate in the work. Yanzi alone had heard of its principles. Use the calendar of the Xia Dynasty. Adopt the carriages of the Shang Dynasty and use the imperial crown of the Zhou Dynasty. For music, adopt the dance of the Shao. This is the standard. Later generations have regarded the Spring and Autumn Annals as history and have said that it is confined to praising good and condemning evil. They do not know its fundamental law governing the world. This does not mean that Confucius told Yanzi the fundamental law of Spring and Autumn Annals. The systems of the three dynasties were perfect, and Confucius could add nothing to them. Therefore, he told him the ceremonies and music of the four dynasties. He merely put all the unchanging laws of ancient kings together. When he wrote the Spring and Autumn Annals, he praised good people and condemned evildoers. That was all. The Spring and Autumn Annals embodies many great principles. Although its principles are great, they are as clear as the sun and stars, which can easily be seen. But because its words are subtle and its meanings obscure and its application varies with times and circumstances, it is difficult to understand. It sometimes holds tight and sometimes relaxes. It sometimes gives and sometimes takes. It sometimes advances and sometimes retreats. It is sometimes subtle and sometimes manifest, but in all cases it is in accord with moral principles and attains the mean between refinement and natural substance, proper degree of leniency and severity, and justice with reference to right and wrong. It is the weight and balance for handling things and the norm for judging moral principles. One has to observe 100 things before he can understand the wonder of the work of creation. One has to gather various materials before he can know the operation of building a house. Only a man of the highest intelligence can look into the purpose of the sage on the strength of one principle. Therefore, in studying the Spring and Autumn Annals, one must leisurely immerse and soak himself in it, understand quietly and penetrate it in his mind before he can get its subtle points. kings of later generations know the principles of the spring and autumn and owls, even though they do not possess the virtue of Yu and Tang, they still can use the government of the three dynasties as a model. The learning of the book has not been transmitted since the Qin dynasty. Regretting that the purpose of the sage may not be clear to later generations, I have written this commentary to clarify it so that people of later generations may understand its words, search for its meanings, get its ideas, and use it as their model. The condition of the three dynasties may then be recovered. Although this commentary cannot reveal the profundity of the sage to the last degree, it can perhaps provide the student with the door through which to go into it. The Book of Odes and the Book of History are vehicles of moral principles, whereas the Spring and Autumn and Owls is the sage's application of them. The Book of Odes and the Book of History are comparable to medical prescriptions, whereas the Spring and Autumn and Owls is comparable to the use of the medicine to cure disease. The sage's application of moral principles is found entirely in this book. It has been said, it is better to embody them in the description of actual affairs so they will be concrete, profound, and clear. There are repetitions, such as accounts of military expeditions and alliances, for in order to make the book a total unit, it was necessary to have these. We should not try to find a different meaning in each and every event. Nevertheless, if a different word is used in describing the same event, or if the preceding or following words are different, we must then distinguish the meanings. The place of the Spring and Autumn Annals in the five classics is comparable to that of judgments in the sphere of law. Law is merely prescribed rules of conduct. Not until judgments are made can the application of law be seen. It is, after all, good to study the Spring and Autumn Annals. It describes an event in only one sentence, and in that sentence, what is right and what is wrong become clear. The book is essential to the investigation of principle. Are other classics not used in the investigation of principle? Yes, they are, but while they discuss the meaning of principle, the Spring and Autumn Annals applies it to practical affairs, and therefore right and wrong are brought out more clearly. Hence, it is essential to the investigation of principle. I have often told students to read the Analects, the books of Mencius, and other classics before reading the Spring and Autumn Annals. One must understand moral principles before reading it. What is the standard of the Spring and Autumn Annals? There is no better standard than the doctrine of the mean. In order to understand the doctrine of the mean, there is no better than to understand the balancing factors in an expedient situation. One must achieve the mean according to the circumstance. To strike the middle point between having the skin of one's hand and feet harden and remaining behind a locked door is not the mean. If the skin of one's hand and feet ought to be hardened, then having such skin is the mean. If one ought to lock his door and remain inside, then doing so is the mean. To balance means to weigh. What is to be the balance? It is righteousness and timeliness. We can only go as far as righteousness. One can hardly say anything beyond that. It depends on how one looks at the matter. The commentaries on the Spring and Autumn Annals contain cases. The classic itself contains judgments. Master Chung also said, when I was reading the Spring and Autumn Annals at 20, Huang Ao Yu asked me how to study it. I replied, the commentaries are to be used to inquire into events described in the classic, and the classic is to be used to distinguish wherein the commentaries are right and wherein they are wrong. In reading history, one must not only remember the historical facts, one must understand the principles of order and chaos, peace and danger, rise and decline, existence and extinction. For example, in reading the Chronicle of Emperor Cao, one must understand the reasons for the rise and fall and the order and chaos in the 400 years of the House of Han. This is also learning. Whenever the teacher was halfway through a history, he would close the book to think and inquire into the reasons for successes and failures before he finished it. Whenever something seemed to be wrong, he would give it further careful thought. Sometimes people succeeded by good luck or failed by bad luck. Nowadays, people see the success and forthwith regard it as right, and see the failure and forthwith regard it as wrong, without realizing that in the success there may very well be elements of wrong, and in the failure there may very well be elements of right. In reading history, we must understand the subtle, incipient, activating forces of the order and chaos shown in the writings of sages and worthies, and why virtuous men accepted or declined official positions and advanced or withdrew. This is the investigation of things. In the middle of the Yuan Yu period, 1086 to 93, a visitor came to see Cheng Yi. There was no other book on the table except a printed copy of the Tang Chant, Mirror of the Government of the Tang Dynasty. The teacher said, "I have seen this book only recently. There has been no such discussion since the Three Dynasties." Master Hung Chu Chasai said, "It should not be said that the remarks on the order of the hexagrams is not where the deep meanings of the sage lie. When you want to put a thing away somewhere, you will carefully find the right place. How much more carefully would the sage be with regard to the Book of Changes? Although the remarks lack extremely good principles, generally speaking, it has significant meaning everywhere. When we read a book by the sage, we must be comprehensive and careful. How can one understand the work of a master carpenter by looking at only one hewing of his axe? One must have a broad mind and a wide perspective before one can read this section on the office of heaven, for its plan is on a large scale. If one does not possess a broad mind and goes off his way in order to explore exhaustively one thing after another so as to acquire such a mind, he will surely fail. To the Buddhists, the universe seems as small as pennies. Their minds are perfectly broad, but since they have never handled any big thing, they are incapable of handling ordinary affairs. If you give them a penny, they are at a loss as to what to do." Chang Sai further said, "It is difficult to read the section on the duties of the chief minister of the office of heaven, for unless one has a broad mind and a great heart which can embrace all its functions, one will forget this while he remembers that. When all the affairs of the empire are in one office, one must treat this fact as one behaves when he captures a dragon or a snake or seizes a tiger or a leopard. It will not do unless he devotes his whole mind and energy to it. The other five sections are easy to read, for each deals with only one office. Among the ancients, Mencius alone understood the Book of Odes, because he taught that we should anticipate the will of the poets in our thought. The will of the poets is perfectly ordinary and simple, and no desperate effort is required to find it out. If one studies poems with a sense of desperation, one has already lost his original mind. How can he understand the will of the poets? The nature and feelings of poems are warm, genial, tranquil, at ease, and mature. They are expressed in words in an open and smooth manner. Now if one must search for them as if he is walking on a rough road, his mind is narrow and obstructed to start with, and there is no way for him to succeed. The feelings of poets are basically happy and at ease. It is only because their happy and leisurely feelings are stimulated by current events that they express their will in poems." The Book of History is difficult to read properly, or few people have the broad mind it requires. However, it is not difficult if one merely wants to know the literal meaning. Other books have an order, for example, The Great Learning. It goes from the investigation of things and the extension of knowledge to bringing peace to the world. There is a certain order. The book of history, however, begins right away with big things like the canon of Yao. If one does not read enough, he will have no method of inquiry and comparison by which to find the essence of moral principles. Books are intended to preserve and support one's mind. If one relaxes for a while, his moral character will be neglected as long as he is relaxing. If one reads, his mind will always maintain itself. If not, he will never understand moral principles. In reading a book, one should recite it silently. Often excellent thoughts will come to him at midnight or while he is sitting in meditation. If one does not remember what he reads, his thoughts will not arise. After one has thoroughly understood the great foundation of a book, however, it will be easy to remember. The reason for reading is to resolve one's doubts and to clarify what one does not understand. If with each reading one learns something, new, his learning will advance. When one doubts where nothing doubtful seems to exist, one really advances. The six classics must be gone through one after another. In repeated cycles, the student will find that their moral principles are unlimited. With every step that he advances, he sees something different. In reading books like The Doctrine of the Mean, one simply must understand all the sentences so that they can develop and clarify each other's meaning. In ancient times, there was no spring and autumn annals. Confucius himself wrote it. Mencius alone understood it. Unless one thoroughly understands moral principles, one is not qualified to study it. Former scholars studied it without this qualification, and their theories are therefore mostly forced.